ओके मैम, यू कैन स्टार्ट.
A very warm morning to everyone. I am pleased to invite our eminent speaker, Dr. Anil Kumar, and all the participants to third day's session. In yesterday's session, we had an opportunity to gain some insight into machine learning types, algorithms, different parameters of neural networks, activation functions, etc., with examples. We enthusiastically look forward to today's session. I humbly welcome Dr. Anil Kumar to commence the session.
Yeah, thank you. Let me share the screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir. You can start, sir.
Yeah. Participants are there. Most of them are came.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. 40 members came, sir. Okay. You can start, sir. It is already full. No problem. You can start, sir. They will join in the middle.
So today's session will talk on how to build a speaker recognition using Gaussian mixture models and neural network models, and also I will show you demonstration of those systems using Python. Okay. So as we discussed in the first session, that speech has a lot of information like message. It has information like language, speaker, etc. So the goal of these corresponding systems is that, you know, extract that information from the speech signal. For example, speaker recognition means I will extract speaker information from the speech signal. So basically, you want to see the difference between the man and machine way of recognizing the speech. So what we'll do is we'll listen the speech, and we already know, you know, if they are known speaker, we already know how their speech will be, and then based on that we'll recognize. But in using a machine, okay, but machine has to extract some features from the speech signal and then model it using some machine learning approaches. So the way human being recognize the speaker and the way machine recognize the speaker is different. Okay, that is why it is a challenging problem. This automatic speech recognition has a lot of potential application. For example, we can use it as a biometric. Speaker information can present in the speech can be used as a biometric, because everybody's speech is unique, and we can use it as a for bank password, for the bank transactions or laptop, like that. But here nowadays, to deploy that system, that speaker recognition system, in practical application, the biggest issue is the speaker spoofing. Okay, now speaker recognition, whatever I am talking now, is not new. Actually, it is there from last 30-40 years, and then I am just demonstrating the system of speaker recognition just to give an experience of AI techniques, how neural networks and GMMs can be used to build the system. But currently this system is well advanced and it can be practically deployed. But only bottleneck here is now a lot of work is happening on speaker spoof detection. That means if I want to use speaker recognition in practical and as a biometric, then biggest problem is like somebody can mimic kind of my voice. And second problem is biggest problem, one of the hard problem here is somebody can record my speech and play back to the system. Okay, so whenever I'm using my password, somebody recorded my voice and then playing back that to the system, then it is a heart attack. If quality of recording is good, then system can't distinguish between original speech and the spoofed speech. And other thing is now technology of speech synthesis advanced, then if I have 1 hour of speech, I can generate any that person voice. So these are the different attacks, like voice conversion or speech synthesis attack. and this replay attack. So these attacks to the speaker recognition system is getting a lot of attention now. A lot of work is happening in that direction. One of my PhD student is also about to submit his thesis on speaker spoof detection. So that I am not talking on, but if you want to know the what is happening, just I want to inform you. And this also can be speaker recognition, also can be used for speaker forensic investigation, because maybe lot we can get the recordings in through mobile exchange or through some other recordings. Whenever some events happening, some unfortunate events happening, then by using speaker recognition, we may detect the speaker. Who is that speaker? Who is there in that conversation? Okay, so for forensic investigation also, the speaker recognition is useful. And there are three types of systems in that. The most popular are the system, what is called speaker recognition, is only that text independent speaker recognition. Okay, that is the system what we usually build. Okay, in the out of these three categories also, more main important one is speaker recognition versus speaker verification. Okay, speaker recognition, it is the same for, this is anyway same for any recognition versus verification problem. That is a flower recognition versus flower verification. The name itself tells, no, flower recognition means I don't know what flower it is. I will test with all the models and say that what flower it is, depending on the probability, highest probability. For example, flower verification, for example, if you say flower verification means I will tell it is some flower, then the system has to verify whether it's a correct claim or not. Okay, verification, that is means 1:1 problem. For example, in speaker recognition, identification means I will take one test case. I don't know who is that speaker. I will test with all the speaker models. And if you say particular, based on the probabilities of the models, we'll say that test case is, this test case belong to particular speaker. On the other hand, speaker verification means I will say, I'm Anil, then system will take my model and see that whether it is actually correct or wrong. If it is, somebody is wrongly claiming, we should reject them. If somebody is rightly claiming, we should accept them. Okay, verification means we have to verify 1:1 problem. This identification is 1:n problem. Usually in identification problems, we usually prepare a confusion matrix. Confusion matrix means we take this one, some particular test case, and we'll see that where it is getting recognized. Okay, we'll start filling that confusion matrix. From the diagonal elements of the confusion matrix, we'll calculate the percentage. Okay, speaker identification or any identification problem, we'll evaluate based on percentage. I'll show you anyway in the demo that percentage. And speaker verification or any verification problem is evaluated based on equal error rate. There is something called EER, equal error rate. That means whenever, it is 1:1 problem, no, I will put some threshold, probability threshold. If it is more than threshold, I will accept the speaker. If it is less than threshold, I will reject the speaker. Okay. Whenever I will get a test case and a claim that he is a particular speaker, I will take a particular model and test it. Then if probability is more than some threshold, then I will accept. If it is less than threshold, I will reject. This threshold, if you keep very high threshold, what happens? All false ones may get rejected, but sometimes true one also get rejects. Whenever you put a threshold very low, all genuine ones will get accepted. At the same time, wrong one also may get accepted. So we took a threshold at which both the errors are equal. That means false acceptance rate and true rejection rate. False acceptance rate means you are accepting false claims. True rejection rate means you are rejecting the true one. It is a threshold at which these two errors are same is called equal error rate. Ideally, it should be zero. I should put a threshold at both the errors are zero, but it is very difficult to put that kind of threshold. So usually verification problems are done using equal error rate. But as we are building now today, we are building only identification system. So we'll evaluate based on percentage. I will show you the confusion matrix and percentage. If you're already working in machine learning or AI, you already know these basics. And text dependent versus text independent means, for example, like a password. Okay, I want to use not only I will speak, at the same time I will speak a particular code word or like a code sentence. Then that is a text dependent speaker recognition. I should speak, but I should speak particular sentence only. Then that is the text dependent actually. Let us say text independent means you use some data for my training. I will use whatever I want to speak. I will speak. You should recognize my voice. That is the text independent. Usually we desire text independent. For example, for forensic investigation or those purposes, we don't know the predefined voice. So we want based on we'll model based on our previous data. And we want to test with the new data. And there is something called closed set versus open set. This is nobody is attempting this. That means whenever test case comes, we have to see whether it is already modeled or not. If it is not modeled, you model it. Otherwise, you test it with the existing models. But it is very difficult to know whether we already modeled or not until unless somebody claims. Okay. So don't worry about this closed versus open set. But usually the popular one is text independent speaker recognition or verification. This already we discussed verifying the identity claim of speaker, identifying the speaker of the speech signal. That is identification. Yeah, text dependent, independent also I covered. Closed set, open set also I told. Yeah. So this is a cycle for any other system also. That any AI system. Okay, so what are the cycles? Cycle is that you take the data and extract the features and you do the training and then do the testing. So here these two should be interchanged. That means segmental means actually 10 to 40 milliseconds. So subsegmental means 1 to 5 milliseconds. These two wrongly typed here. So feature extraction. So we have to extract some features from the speech signal. You have seen the speech signal in the first session, right? You have seen it is a non-stationary signal. But if you zoom it and see, we have seen some kind of periodicity. So to extract the features, okay. What we think is that, as we also discussed in the first session, speech has two things, that is vocal tract system and excitation source. Excitation source acts as a source and then it will, vocal tract system acts as a resonator. Our assumption here is that everybody, God has gifted unique vocal tract system. That's why everybody's speech is different. So what we do is that from the speech signal, take frame by frame, usually the segmental, which is the 10 to 40 millisecond is the most famous one. That way we'll take some 20 millisecond. If you remember, I touched upon this 20 millisecond in the first session. The 20 milliseconds is nothing but 2 to 3 pitch cycles. Okay, pitch means rate of vocal fold vibration. So very small segment of 20 millisecond we'll take and we'll apply algorithm called Mel frequency capsule quotients, which I have not mentioned here. There are some other variant features also there. So basically we'll take those 20 millisecond things and then go to frequency domain. But again, frequency domain also some variations are there. Then we'll go to Capstrom domain. Capstrom is nothing but, here also we mentioned here, capsule analysis. Capstrom is nothing but, if you see, first four letters of Capstrom, if you reverse, what is that? That is spectral. Okay, first four letters you reverse, it is capsule. Spectrum, first four letters, if you reverse, that is capstrom. That means capstrom is inverse of spectrum, but not only inverse of spectrum, it is inverse of logarithm of spectrum. Okay, so that's what it gives them, reliable features related to vocal track. Don't worry about that. We'll get some feature numbers from every 20 milliseconds. Okay, if you understand up to that, it's fine. Okay, then what we'll do is that we'll take the speaker data, each speaker data, and extract the features and model it using Gaussian mixture model or neural network and save those reference models. This is the block diagram of speaker modeling. So for example, you take some 2 minutes of data. Okay, 2 minutes you have taken. That means how many seconds? 120 seconds. In this 120 seconds, there may be some silence and unvoiced part, which is not useful for your feature extraction. We'll remove that. Let us say you have some 90 seconds, let us say 100 seconds of speech left out. 100 seconds in that every 20 milliseconds we are extracting features. Let us say we extract 20 millisecond features with 10 millisecond shift. That means my first frame is 0 to 20 and next frame is 10 to 30 because they want to use some that Hamming or Hanning window to give importance to the each part. So we'll shift it only by 10 milliseconds. So so let us say 100 seconds and every 100 milliseconds you are getting 10 features and 1 second means 100 and you have like that 100 seconds. So 100,000, let us say you have some 10,000 features for every speaker. Roughly we have, let us say, 10,000 features, because why I'm calculating that, it has some meaning, because by like giving the demo it will be useful. Okay, let us say I'm roughly getting some some 10,000 features, or let us say you have don't have 100 seconds of speech, you have only, let us say, 50 seconds of speech, then I have 5,000 feature vectors. These 5,000 feature vectors are representing a particular speaker in late 90s. Okay, they want to model the speaker recognition. They got some features like these feature vectors, like 1,000, 2,000, or whatever, let us say 5,000 feature vectors they got. They want to see how to model these features, how to model this. Then they thought, you know, you can use any model, like, you know, existing models, like any machine learning model we can use. But there, in the late 90s, before neural network comes, this Gaussian mixture model is the one of the famous approach in speaker recognition. Okay, what it means is that you take the speaker data and that 5,000 features, you fit them into multiple Gaussians. You fit them into multiple Gaussians rather than one Gaussian. Usually, whenever data is more and you want to fit into some distribution, then if no distribution is fitting, then we'll assume it as a Gaussian. So here in this 5,000 feature vectors, I don't know what distribution it will fit in. So to model them, I'm modeling as a Gaussian mixture model, okay? Gaussian means, all of you know, I think, Gaussian. Gaussian will have mean and variance. Gaussian mixture model means I have three parameters, Gaussian mixture model: weight, mean, and variance. Three parameters will be there: weight, mean, and variance. Weight means weight for each Gaussian, mean for each Gaussian, and standard deviation for each Gaussian. For example, you give this, you take this example. Let us say I have taken some 5 Gaussians and I modeled two speakers, let us say red is one speaker and green is one speaker. You can see that the distributions are different for different speakers. The weights, means, and variances what you got for different speakers are different. Okay, so in that way, whenever you get a test case, you can hypothesize that corresponding model to that speaker, the text case, will give you the high probability. So we are fitting that into with the multiple Gaussians. Now here the question is, having more Gaussians is good or less Gaussians is good? To model the speaker, I am collecting some features, so I am fitting them into Gaussians. Now my question here is, having more Gaussians is good or less Gaussians is good? Obviously, more Gaussians is good because more Gaussians will capture the more variations. Okay. For example, like red, another speaker also may be like similar to red, but if you take the, let us say, 5 Gaussians, and at the moment, let us say you take 10 Gaussians, then there may be different way, they will be further divided so that variations can be captured. So more Gaussians is good. But here the problem is, once you fix the number of features, and if you increase the number of Gaussians, the performance increases, and after some point it start decreases. Performance increases, after some point it start decreases. That is because it is not that number of Gaussians is bad. You know, more Gaussians is bad. More Gaussians is good, but I don't have enough number of feature vectors. I don't have enough number of feature vectors to train. Okay, because every Gaussian should get some point, data points, to get mean and variance. Otherwise, mean will become zero, variance will become zero. Those Gaussians won't contribute. So, for example, I calculated, no, right? Let us say some 5,000 features are there. If 5,000 features are there, I started, let us say, with 8 Gaussians, performance is something. I started with 16 Gaussians, performance improved. 32 Gaussians, performance improved. Let us say it is improving, but let us say the moment it becomes some 128 or 256 Gaussians, the performance started decreasing. Because, but 250, let us say even 128 Gaussians, if you have 128 Gaussians and I have only 5,000 data points, many Gaussians out of this 128 may not get any data points. So their means and variance will be zero. So they will confuse the speaker. Okay. So now Gaussian mixes model is working better, but we want more Gaussian. To solve that problem, anyway, this is identification verification. To solve that problem, so the concept of universal background model is proposed. The concept of universal background model. That means, what is this universal background model? Universal background model is, for example, I want to model, let us say, ECE faculty speaker recognition system. What I will do, I will take other department faculty data and combine all of that and make some 1 hour of data or 2 hours of data. Okay. From each speaker I want to model, you give me 1 hour of data, it is not possible, because how can we collect 1 hour of data and for each speaker and model it? It is a time consuming and not scalable process. So what I will do, I will take some multiple speakers data and combine all of them and make 1 hour or 2 hours. Okay, so then those 2 hours data, I will extract features so that I will get lot of features, because I have 2 hours. So every 20 millisecond I will get feature vector, I will get huge number of feature vectors. With that, I will build background GMM, universal background model GMM. Okay, that GMM, maybe I can assume some 1024 mixtures. Or 512 mixtures or 1024 mixtures. So those 1024 mixtures can be trained because I have so many number of feature vectors. So I will get some mean variance and weights. Those are non-zero numbers. Then what I will do for each speaker modeling, I will take UBM as a starting point and I will I will extract features vectors from small speech. Let us say 5 seconds, 10 seconds or 1 minute or 5 minutes at most. I don't take 1 hour from each speaker, at most 1 or 2 minutes or 5 minutes I will take, and then I will extract the features and I will change this universal background model as per my features. Okay, that adaptation program I will use, adaptation process, so that will be adapted. So that system used to give very good accuracy in early 2000s, that universal background model. Then what they thought, that 1024 mixtures are there. That means 1024 means variance and weights are coming. All may be not contributing to the speaker. So can we apply some joint factor analysis on top of that and reduce the dimension and extract the speaker specific things, is called I vector. I vector means intermediate vector, because this UBM, after building the UBM, from those UBM parameters, I will extract something called I vector. Till last 5-6 years, those are the baseline system. That means that is the best system of speaker recognition is iVector. But later now, neural networks and different architectures of neural networks have come. Now, if you ask what is a baseline system, the baseline system is deep neural networks with attention architectures. Okay, with attention architecture, that is becoming the baseline for the speaker recognition system. Okay, so these are the numbers. Okay, I think we got some vague idea on what is speaker recognition and how it is evolved over the years. So let me demonstrate this using I usually earlier demonstrate these systems using MATLAB, but now it is better to move it to Python. So now these demos are in Python. Just for your understanding, I am just taken some sample trained data from some 10 speakers. I have 10 speakers. And each speaker I have taken some 8 files. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, each speaker some 8 files for training. Okay, some 8 files for training and for testing, and each speaker I took some 2 files for testing. Okay, 2 files for testing and 8 files for training. Okay, and let me open now for demo. demonstrating this, I am using IPython. Okay. I am opening that IPython. IPython can be open using Jupyter Notebook. The advantage is that you can see all of them in the browser like this. In your browser will open. In your browser, we can open this. Okay, and these are my codes, GMM code, and this is my DNN code. You can see the advantage here is in Jupyter IPython, you can write the program here, and you can write one program, or you can write kernel by kernel, and then block by block in the kernel, and you can, once you run, you can see the output here itself. Okay, now this is a program for Gaussian mixture model. Okay, these are the packages of Python which need to be there to calculate the Fourier transform and plotting the things and all. And this package Librosa is the package which required for feature extraction from the speech. And to build your Gaussian mixture model, there is a package called sklearn. This has programs for Gaussian mixture modeling and conventional machine learning model. Or you can use, there are other libraries called PyTorch, like that, and all of them are free. So only thing is that you should know how to make use of them. And now here, these are the parameters for some of these parameters for feature extraction. Don't worry, but here the parameter which can vary, now I can vary. Yesterday also we focused that I have only few parameters in conventional modeling to vary. But on the other hand, I have so many parameters in neural networks to vary. So this session, I will also make use of that point. So this is the programs for Gaussian mixture model. Okay, so here I have, once my things are fixed, I have only this parameter called number of mixtures, n underscore mixtures. I can vary with 8 to 16 like that. And as we discussed, if the number of mixtures are increasing, the performance increases. And after some point, it starts decreases because we don't have enough number of feature vectors. I took only 8 files, no? 8 files means hardly, if you remove silence and all, you may get some 15-16 seconds of speech. From 15-16 seconds of speech, we'll get very, let's say 1500 features like that. That 1500 features are not enough to train very large number of mixtures. Okay? And any machine learning algorithm, any machine learning approach or any problem, the sequence of steps are similar. The sequence of steps are, take the data and divide it into training data and test data. And from training data, you extract the features and save it. And from test data also, you extract the features and save it. And from training data, you take the features, whatever you extracted from the features, you train the models. You save those models. Now we have models as well as test features. Both of them, you make use of them and create a confusion matrix and give the percentage. So these are the steps. So we have written here, these are the initial packages, and then this is a step for training feature extraction. Okay, this will extract the features, and then we'll also training the Gaussian mixture model, and we say that training got completed. Then we'll extract the test features. Okay, and then we will test them and create a confusion matrix. So let me run and show you. Kernel, restart and run all. Okay. So in Jupyter framework, it opens in browser, and whenever you see star means that block is getting running. Okay, once that block runs, then the star will goes off, and you can see this block is running now. And the good part is that you can see the output here itself. You can see it is taking one speaker by one speaker folder and extracting the features. Okay. So, and modeling also. So you can see those things. So now training got completed. These are the features just printed for you. Okay. Yeah. Now, oh, okay. It is got 95%. Okay. So this is the confusion matrix because we have two test cases from every speaker. So this also should have been printed here so that you can see. So what this confusion matrix means, we have 10 speakers. So we'll create 10 by 10 matrix, 10 cross 10 matrix. Speaker 1, speaker 2, speaker 3 up to speaker 10. Here also speaker 1, speaker 2, speaker 3, so on speaker 10. And we'll see, let us say I'm giving speaker 2. We'll see whether it is speaker 2 as recognized as speaker 2 or somewhere else. So you can see most of the time it is recognized as a corresponding speaker. For example, you take here, it is speaker 6 or 7. Speaker 7 once recognized as speaker 7 and other time it is recognized as speaker 6. It is confused. So that is why it is called confusion matrix. In the matrix, we'll also can see our test case is confused with what. Okay. So if number of mixtures, for example, I took 8 and you got good percentage. For example, you increased it to 32. Okay. For example, you increased it to 32. So now I am again running and you can see. One by one running is going on. Training completed and let us see how testing is going on. Okay, you see a number of what happened now here, number of mixtures increased. Now the percentage got reduced. It should have been improved, but if you have enough number of features, but as I don't have enough number of features, the performance start decreasing. But let us say I got earlier 90 or 95, whatever, and now I got after that. If I want to fine tune my parameters, I don't have any parameters to fine tune here because I have only parameter in my hand here in Gaussian mixture model is the number of mixtures. That means number of Gaussians. Number of Gaussians. I can number of Gaussians which I can use to model. Okay. But on the other hand, for example, you take the same data, same thing we are doing with the let us say neural networks. Okay, it is not deep neural network, by the way. It's neural network because it's small data. Okay, we are using few number of layers and few number of neurons only. But the same, if it become deep neural network also, approach will be same. Okay, so here you see, here I'm using this Keras background. Keras is the package for neural networks implementation. In the background of Keras, the neural networks are supported by using either Theano background or TensorFlow background. TensorFlow is from Google, given Google packages, and Theano is from some foreign university. These programs are written with Theano background, but now it is better to use TensorFlow background one, or even many other new approaches have come. Okay, so now here you see, here these many parameters are in my hand. Okay, you see, all your neural network is only this module and this module, and you have so many, let us say, like yesterday we discussed, number of hidden layers, number of second hidden layer. Okay, and input will be fixed. Okay, depends on the feature vector. And what is the batch size? Like yesterday we discussed, what is batch size? Number of batch size. That means what is the batch size from each class we'll use for training, and the number of epochs. And these are all parameters in my hand. And again, I have here. Once you here, this is the only code for required for neural network. Just I'm taking sequential model. That means feed forward neural network. Here you can take another LSTM or you can take CNN or whatever it is. And then here I can take dense. Dense means fully connected network. I can take dropout also, or I can take any other thing here. And I can use different activation function here, okay, ReLU or tan hyperbola or sigmoid. And here I can also use different activation function, but usually output layer will use softmax. So these many parameters in my hand, even if I started getting percentage like 50, 60, but I can fine tune these parameters and get high accuracy. Okay, that's why they are getting famous. Okay, now some parameters are fixed. Let us see kernel and restart all restart. And see what percentage we will get. Then now you can see the training is happening. Okay, here 7th epoch is happening. Okay, that means 8th iteration is happening. Okay, this is the input layer and output layer. We have in between two hidden layers. Okay, so we tested and we got percentage accuracy, utterance level accuracy of 70%. Okay, so this is the confusion matrix at the frame level. That means usually what happens is that we'll take one sentence as for testing. So that also we'll get a decision from every 20 milliseconds. Because every 20 millisecond we'll extract features and give it to the model. So every 20 millisecond we'll get the feature vector and get the decision. This is a frame level decision based on the, let us say, majority of the frames are saying it is a particular speaker, then that particular speaker will be selected. So you can see frame level accuracy may be less, but utterance level accuracy will be high. So to address this problem, normal neural networks will take frame level decision. To address this problem, now current thing is that DNN with attention. That means, I will show those one or two slides on DNN with attention. Before that, what I am trying to emphasize here is that, we have so many, let us say we got 70 here. Now, let me change the batch size and let me change slightly the number of neurons and see what happens. training is going on. Okay, training of last iteration is happening. Yeah, done. Yeah, you got same 70%. That means the model parameters what you have changed also not changing the performance. Still, what you can do is you keep on try with the different things. Let us say you keep it this 60 only and make it this as 35. And batch size maybe 10. There is something called here cross validation zero. No, cross validation we are not doing. Cross validation means if you have a training data and we'll take some set of data as a training and some test for testing, then we'll get some accuracy just to validate that. Then we also change the training data and test data. Okay, some other data we'll use for testing and remaining data for training. Like that, we can do that. Is also called multifold validation. Multifold validation will make sure that, you know, if you change the training data, test data, how your system is working. Okay, it's not that particular data I'll use for training and particular test data I'll use for testing, then my accuracy, you got high accuracy, then you can't say this is my system performance, because you have to thoroughly test your system. What will happen to your system when you change the training data and test data? So that cross validation is also very important, or multifold validation of your system is very important. Usually we use some 5-fold validation or 10-fold validation. That means you will divide your data into, let us say 5-fold validation means you will divide data into 5 parts. Let us say 4 parts you will use for training, 1 part for testing. Again, remaining, you will change the test block into another module and remaining 4 you will use for training like that. So we'll complete all 5 times training and testing and we'll see what is the accuracy, average accuracy. That's what we'll report it to the community, that this is what my system performance after doing the cross validation or multifold validation. Again, 70 only, it is not improving. So let me try with batch size of 40. Let it run. Meanwhile, we can also see what is this attention mechanism. This is I vector molding. We got same 70. We are stuck at 70. Okay. It's not speaker recognition, but you can apply it on speaker recognition also. So we proposed something called DNN with attention. for speaker recognition also it is already proposed. So what is this DNN with attention is, you have neural network. What we'll do is that, we'll take the last hidden layer outputs, okay? And then one, this is for one feature vector, this is for other feature vector like that. Let's say I have T feature vectors. I'll take that and I will weigh them from the another small neural network, that is attention network, which is already trained using this while training time. While testing time, you will take them, these one by one frame level hidden layer outputs, and will weigh it to the appropriate weight from this attention vector, and will combine them and create a something called context vector. Based on this, we'll take a decision. So we don't take the frame level decision. We are combining all of that and taking the utterance level decision. That is what giving better performance nowadays. Okay, so the state of the art, if you ask, the state of the art speaker recognition systems are using DNN with attention, or DNN with multi-head attention. That means instead of one attention, they are using multiple attention networks. Okay, so and more importantly, now a lot of work is happening. Speaker spoofing thing. Now speaker recognition got some saturation, means they are giving better performances, those systems. Now to deploy them practically, this speaker spoofing is the biggest bottleneck. So now people are building a system. That system main purpose is that before giving to the speaker recognition system, you have to verify and see whether it is a genuine input or whether it is a spoofed output. So sometimes, let us say for mobiles and all, we can also use, like, instead of this spoofing system, we can also use some camera or something, that whether the person is live speaking, then only take that input. But all the time camera may not be available, so we have to depend only on speech, let us say. So it is very important to see whether the genuine speech or somebody is spoofing the speech, then recognize the speaker. Okay. So by combining today and yesterday session, you can see the advantage of neural networks over Gaussian mixture model. Here we have so many parameters to fine tune. Okay, compared to conventional machine learning model. Okay, so yeah, I like to stop here. So I'm happy to take some questions. You can type in the chat box so that everybody can see and I can answer.
Sir, I think no one is asking any questions, sir. Chat box also it is empty.
Nobody understanding anything, or nobody want to ask. No, the people are asking. Let us
see. Okay.
Which model is best to recognize speech? Speech recognition, or you want to ask speaker recognition? For whatever may be the model, now best thing is neural networks only, but different architectures of neural network. In speech recognition, that RNN, recurrent neural network, followed by CTC, Connexionless Temporal Classifier, that is a baseline model. And for speaker recognition, it is DNN with attention architecture. Can a system can recognize the speakers based on pitch, if number of speakers for English? No, pitch is not enough. Pitch only is not enough. For example, you want to recognize the people, do you think that roll number is enough? Because all may not have roll number and some may have similar number. So Similarly, simple pitch is not enough. We have to extract that, different pitches like Mel frequency capsule quotients like that, and then use them for modeling. Want to start career in speech processing? You have to, what you, it is same, cycle is same for research, cycle is same for any area. You have to get the basics of it and start reading the papers and then work accordingly. Now a lot of material related to speech processing is available, okay? Right now, the thing is that conventional speech processing problems are very difficult to address because they have come to very saturation stage. So better is try to combine speech plus music or speech plus text, or take the practical problems like speaker spoofing, what I discussed, or any other problems related like that. So there is no point that if you say now I want to work on speech recognition, speaker recognition, those are all kind of solved problems now. Okay, so you should be careful while selecting the problem. So what are the features that can be considered for speech processing other than MSCC and pitch? Yeah, there are features like PLP, perceptual linear prediction quotients. There are LPCC, linear prediction capsule quotients, and now they are getting filter bank based features, MLR features like that. From spectrogram, we'll extract some filter bank based features. But out of all these, this MFCC features are giving better results for the over the years. Yeah. Maybe difficult. I think, brain nerves processing and extracting the what they want to intend to speak. The main thing is everything is machine learning, right? So if you have good amount of data based mapping the nerves and voice, if you have a huge amount of data like that, and then we may try to build that system. Now everything is boiling down to availability of data. There may be exciting applications and ideas, but if you don't have an amount of data related to it, we can't do much. Now natural language processing, speech processing, image processing has huge demand in companies. Okay, because in turn, anything related to AI, artificial intelligence, is huge demand in the because now automation phase of industries is going on. So yeah, background noise, there are, that is also kind of saturation field. Lot of techniques are there. One is like simple spectra subtraction, estimate the noise spectrum and subtract it from the speech spectrum, or minimum mean square estimation, or now the latest technique, if you want to ask, they are now, even for speech enhancement, they are using the neural networks. You give the noisy speech and neural network will give output of clean speech. I have not yet explored, I have done signal processing based speech enhancement, but I have not yet explored speech enhancement using deep neural networks. But if you ask state of the art, now people are using neural networks for that speech enhancement also.
Okay, ma'am. Vasmati, ma'am, you can conclude, ma'am.
Thank you very much for facilitating us with much required knowledge regarding speaker recognition using different models in today's session. We would also like to extend our gratitude to all the inquisitive participants for all your cooperation. Have a nice day. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.